all the type of resource allocation graph. Resource allocation graph with one instance of resources, with more than one instance of resources. Plus one more thing, how you can see that there would be a deadlock only by seeing the resource allocation graph. We will also discuss that thing. So what is resource allocation graph? See, if you are taught with the help of some diagrams or graphs or pictorial view, then I guess you get the concept easily. So to describe the deadlock in a better way, or you can say to describe deadlock more precisely, some directed graphs would be used, and those directed graphs are known as resource allocation graph, or you can say system resource allocation graph. See, as the name suggests, resource allocation graph, how the resources are to be allocated among processes, that thing is represented using graphs, and that is known as resource allocation graph. So these are basically used to describe the deadlock more precisely. Now if we are talking about graph, then obviously there would be set of vertices and set of edges. Okay, here also we have set of vertices V. Now here we have two type of set of edges. One is set of processes, maybe suppose from P1 to Pn, and next one is set of resources R1, R2, R3 to Rm. Now set of edges. Edges are also of two types. One is request edge and one is assignment edge. Request means if a directed edge is from process to resource like this. Suppose process is PI and this direction of this edge is from process to resource, then this is known as request edge. Here you can say a process is requesting for some resource, or you can say and waiting for that resource. And if that resource is available and that resource is, you know, assigned to that process, then this request edge would be turned into assignment edge. Assignment edge would be in opposite direction from the request edge, means it would be from resource, direction would be from resource to process like this. Resource RJ to process, direction would be like this, and this is known as assignment edge, means that that resource has been allocated to that process. Two types of edges are there, request and assignment. Fine. Now, how to represent that process, how to represent a resource and like this in this graph? See, this square would be used to represent a resource type. This circle would be used to represent a process. One more thing, what is instance of a resource type? See, instance means, let us suppose we have two processor, then you can say, or you can say two CPU. Then you can say we have two instance of one resource type CPU. Or you can say one printer is there. So resource type is what? Printer. And if we have five printer, then you can say resource type is printer and instance of that resource is five. We have five instances of a printer, or you can say five instances of a resource type printer. So instances would be represented with the help of these dots within this square, or you can say rectangle. Now let us take this resource allocation graph. See, in this case, as you can see, we have set of vertices, means we have set of processes and set of resources. So set of vertices are, see, P1, P2, P3, these are set of processes. Fine. You can just write like this, P1, P2 and P3. And set of resources are R1, R2, R3 and R4. Set of edges are, see, these are edges. This one, this one, this one, this one and this one. Request edge and assignment edge. We have already discussed request edge would be from process to resource type. Here one more thing you have to take care. See, request edge would be from process to this rectangle, not it. Request edge would not go inside this rectangle. Fine. Request edge would be from process to the box of this rectangle, and assignment edge would be from this dot. You can say that instance R1 is having only one instance, from the instance of the resource to that process. if you want to draw this more accurately, then you have to take care of this thing also. See, or see here you can say all the request is this one and this one are from process to this box, and all the assignment edges are from this dot to this process, from this dot to this process. Fine. So here you can say set of edges would be, see, P1 to R1, P1 to R1, or you can say from R2 to P1, and like this you can write all the edges. So this would be set of edges. Now if I come to the instances of the resources, then what you can say, one instance of R1, one instance of R3, two instance of the resource type R2, and 1, 2, 3, three instances of resource type R4. You will find out this diagram in your Galvin book also. Next thing is, if you discuss the process states, then here you can say this process P1 is holding which resource? P1 is holding, see, only one instance. We have two instances of this R2, but P1 is holding only one instance of resource type R1 and waiting request edge, matlab it is waiting for an instance of resource type R1 and holding one in resource type R2. What about P2? P2 is holding, see, one instance of resource type R1, one instance of resource type R2, and P2 is waiting for an instance of resource type R3. What about P3? P3 is holding an instance of resource type R3, and obviously P3 is not waiting for any instance. Fine. And this R4 is free. So this is the process states. See, one thing you have to take care of, that is very important thing. If there is no cycle in this resource allocation graph, then you can say there would be no deadlock, that no process would be in deadlocked state. Yes, fine. Second thing is, if cycle exists in resource allocation graph, then deadlock may exist. I am not saying deadlock will exist. Deadlock may or may not exist, that depends. We will discuss that thing also. So now we will discuss two resource allocation graph. One graph is having cycle and having deadlock, and second graph which is having cycle but no deadlock is there. Now this is the condition. If your resource allocation graph contains no cycle, then there would be no deadlock in the system. Fine. And second case is, if it contains a cycle, then deadlock may exist. See, then deadlock may exist. We cannot say that if the resource allocation graph contains cycle, then there would be a deadlock. No, deadlock may or may not exist. Fine. We will discuss this case with the help of these two examples. See, this R3 resource type is having two instances. Means at the same time, R3 can be assigned to two processes because it is having two instances. It is having only one instance. So this resource type can be assigned to one process at a time. Okay. Now how you will check from this resource allocation graph that the system is having deadlock or not? If small resource allocation graph is there, then you can check it just by looking at this graph. See, when you are looking at this graph, then check if this graph contains a cycle or not. Yes, this contains a cycle. It is having two cycles. One is this one. Cycle means, or you can say closed path. You will start from one point and you will reach out to that point only. See, we will start from P1. This one, P1 to R1, this one, this one, this one, this one, and finally to this one. One cycle. Second is from P2, this, 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 and this. So here we have two cycles. So if cycle exists, then we cannot say definitely there would be a deadlock, may or may not. Now how to check? First of all you check, is there any process who is in the state of progress or who can execute, who can complete its execution? Check for P1. P1 is waiting for R1. So P1 cannot execute till it gets R1. P2 is waiting for R2, but R2 is held by this P3. So P2 also cannot execute. P3 is waiting for this R3, but this R3 is held, one instance is held by P1, one instance is held by P2, and these both are also in waiting state. So neither P1 nor P2 nor P3 can execute. So here is no progress. So you can say this is a deadlocked state. Or second way is, if a complicated resource allocation graph is given, then just by simply looking in this graph, on this resource allocation graph, you cannot say that it is having deadlock or not. So second method is what? Simply write down how many processes you have, P1, P2 and P3, right? Now resources are R1, R2 and R3. Now it, here we will write allocation. This is, you know, you can say allocation matrix, fine. How many resources or which resource is allocated to which process? Check out from this resource allocation graph, P1. See, P1 is holding which resource? One instance of this resource type R3, only this R3, because P1 is waiting for R1, this is only the assignment edge. So R3 you will write 1, R2 and R1 you will write 0, because P1 is not holding any instance of R1 and any instance of R2. Now check out, what about P2? P2 is holding only one instance of R3, one instance of R3. P2 is holding plus P2 is also holding one instance of R1. From this RAG, from this resource allocation graph, you can easily analyze this thing. P2 is holding R2? No, P2 is not holding R2. P2 is requesting R2. Now what about P3? P3 is holding only one instance of R2. R1, no. R3, no. P3 is waiting for R3. So 0 and 0. So this is the allocation matrix. Now we'll write down the request matrix, or you can say need matrix, for this R1, R2 and R3. What is the request matrix of P1? See, from this graph you can easily check, P1 is requesting R1, one instance of R1, right? P1 is requesting R1. Requesting here, it means you will write 1. P2 is requesting R2? No. Is P2 requesting R3? No. Now what about P2? P2 is requesting what? P2 is requesting R2. P2 is requesting, see, this is requested R2. Is P2 requesting R1? No. P2 requesting R3? No. 0 and 0. What about P3? See, P3 is requesting only R3. R3. P2 is not requesting R2. Sorry, P3 is not requesting R1. Fine. Now, what is available matrix we have? Availability. After the allocation of these resource type, how many resources are still available with us? How many instances of these resource types are available with us? See, R1 is having only one instance and this is allocated to P2. So we don't have any instance of R1. R2 is having only one instance and this is allocated to P3. So we don't have any instance of R2 available. R3. See, R3 is having two instances and both are allocated to one to P1 and one to P2. We don't have any R3. So availability is 0, 0 and 0. Now with this availability, can you fulfill the requirement of, or you can say need of, any process? Check out the request or need matrix of P1. 1, 0, 0. P1 need one instance of R1, but we cannot fulfill with this availability. P2 is requesting 0, 1, 1, but we cannot fulfill this request with this availability. P3 is requesting 0, 0, 1, but we cannot fulfill this request with this availability. So we cannot fulfill request of P1, P2 and P3. It means no process can execute, can complete its execution. It means here we have no progress. because we have zero availability of all the resources. It means this system is in deadlocked state. Now check out with this one. See, this contains a cycle or not? Yes, this graph contains a cycle. This one, yeah, this one, and finally to this one. So this is a cycle, but it doesn't mean that it also contains, it also, in, this system is also in a deadlocked state. You have to check it out. We have P1, P2 and P3. Which process is in the state that it can execute, it can complete its execution? Check out. First of all, check out which process is not waiting for any resource. P1 is waiting, yes. P3 is waiting, yes. P2, is P2 waiting for some resource? No, P2 is not waiting. P2 is holding one instance of R1. Here we have two instances of R1, one instance of R2. P2 is not waiting for anything. It means P2 can complete its execution at some point of time if P2 is not waiting. Fine. And after P2 finishes its execution, then this P2 will release this instance of this resource R1. It means you can delete this edge after the completion of this P2. Now this resource is available. Now one instance of R1 is available. Now see, P1 is requesting instance of R1. Now we can allocate this one instance to P1. Now after this allocation of this R1, P1 is now not waiting for anything. Fine. So P1 can complete its execution. Now after completing this execution, P1 can release this instance, P1 can release this R2 also. Now if R2 is free, then this R2 can be allocated to P3. Now P3 now can complete its execution and our system is not in deadlocked state. And if you check out this with the help of this method, then you can easily check it out. Here we have only two resource type, R1 and R2. Now fill this allocation matrix. P1 is holding which resource? Which resource is allocated to P1? See, this R2 means 1. But P1 is requesting for R1. So here we will write 0. What about P2? P2 is holding which resource? R1 only. What about P3? P3 is holding which resource? One instance of R1. And here we have about R2, P2 is not hold, P3 is not holding R2, that is why we have written 0 here. Now what about request matrix, or you can say need matrix? R1 and R2. Check. P1 is requesting which resource? Only this one, R1, for R1. P1 requesting R2? No, 0, because this is assignment edge. What about P2? P2 is requesting for nothing, neither for R1, neither for R2. So you will write 0 and 0 here, because there is no request edge, only one assignment edge is there. What about P3? P3 is requesting for R2, so he will write 1. Is P3 requesting for R1? No. Now, what is the availability? You have to check how many instances of these resource type are available with us after this allocation. Fine. Now, see, R1 is having two instances, but nothing is available. 0, because one is allocated to P3, one is allocated to P2. What about R2? R2 is having one instance and this one is allocated to P1. So we don't have any R2. So here also availability is 0 and 0. Now check out, with this availability, can you fulfill the requirement of any process? Check out the request of these P1. Request is 1 and 0. But we don't have R1, so we cannot fulfill this request. P2. P2 is having request 0 and 0. Yes. And availability is also 0 and 0. Means you can fulfill this request, P2 request. If you can fulfill the P2 request, it means at some point of time P2 will complete its execution. Fine. And it will release these resources 1 and 0. the number of resources which are allocated to P2 after completion, it will release those resources 1 and 0. So it will release 1, 0. Now availability is 0, 0. It release 1, 0. Now total would be 0 and 1. Now available resources are 1, 0. Now P2 got completed. Now check out which P1 or P3 you can complete, you can fulfill which request with the help of this 1 and 0. P1 request 1, 0, and also we have 1 of R1 and 0 of R2. So we can fulfill this request because P1 only requirement, the requirement of P1 is 1 instance of R2. Fine. So you can allocate this resources to P1. Fine. If you allocate these resources to P1, now availability is 0, 0 again because you have allocated this 1 to this P1. Now, after allocating this 1 and 0, after allocating 1 and 0, the allocation matrix of this P1 will becomes 1 and 0. Here you will allocate 1 and 0. So total would be what? 1 and 1. Fine. Now P1 got completed and P1 will release how many resources? 1 and 1 resources. 1 and 1. So now available are 1 and 1. So available is 1, 1, and request of P3 is only 0 and 1. So can we fulfill this request? Yes, we can fulfill this request. So we will allocate. So it doesn't need any instance of R1. It needs one instance of R2. So we took one instance of R2 from here and allocate to this one. So after allocating, the remaining would be 1 and 0. 1 and 0. Now after allocating, this becomes 0, 1, 1 and 1. Because 1 it already allocated are 1, 0, and 0, 1 is again allocated, so this becomes 1 and 1. After completion, it will release resources, one instance of R1, one instance of R2. Now we add 1, 1. Now total would be 2 and 1. Now P3 got completed. Now after completion of these, after completion of all the three processes, we have what? Two instance of R1 and one instance of R2. Two instance of R1 and one instance of R2. Now all the processes got completed. It means this system does not have any deadlock. So this kind of thing we'll discuss in Penker's algorithm. Then you'll get it very clearly. Fine. This is the way how you can find out from a resource allocation graph, given a resource allocation graph, that deadlock exists or not. See, here the funda is, so if no cycle, then definitely no deadlock. But if cycle is there plus only one instance of the resource type is there, the resource type is having only one instance. Cycle is there plus one instance of the resource type is there, it means definitely there would be deadlock. Cycle, if the resource allocation graph contains cycle plus only one instance of the resource type, okay, then there would be deadlock definitely. Second case is if cycle exists plus more than one instance of resource types are there, then deadlock may exist. You cannot say deadlock will exist, then deadlock may exist. And second case is if RAG contains cycle plus more than one instances of resource types are there, then deadlock may exist. Fine. So in this case, in one instance, this existence of cycle is necessary and sufficient condition for deadlock. But in this case, cycle plus more than one instances are there, then existence of cycle is only necessary condition, not sufficient condition. And if no cycle is there, then there would be no deadlock. And the method how to check from the resource allocation graph that the system is in deadlocked state or not, then either you can check manually if small resource allocation graph is there. If complicated resource allocation graph is there, then you can follow this method. Just draw allocation matrix, request matrix and availability, current availability. And just check with the help of that availability, and you fulfill the request of any process or not. If you are able to fulfill the request, then there would be no deadlock. If you are not able to fulfill the request at any point of time, then obviously that would be there would be deadlock. So I'll see you in the next video. Till then, bye bye, take care.